Welcome back. Today we're taking a look at a watch whose review is long overdue, and that's my Seiko Turtle. And that's because I bought it maybe like 9 months ago. And the reason I bought it is actually pretty simple. I just wanted a Seiko Diver. I never actually had one before. And I primarily wanted it just for the experience of owning it. You see, the way I see my role on this channel isn't really to tell people what to think or what they should buy, but more to just try and describe the experiences of owning these watches, both the good and the bad. And oftentimes the best way to do that is through comparisons. And a Seiko really is the common ground or common experiences that most people have. So I thought for my own benefit, I needed to get a Seiko Diver. But I didn't want an SKX. Even though that's the watch most people say you should get, I really didn't want one because of the movement. So I decided to jump ahead and look at either a Samurai or a Turtle, and I eventually settled on the Turtle. Which was actually the easy part. The harder part was deciding on which Turtle. And as usual, I wanted something just a little different, and I just happened to run across this one, which is the SRPC25, with its black and blue gradient dial. And when I found out that it was nicknamed the Dark Knight Turtle, well, as a Batman fan, that pretty much sealed the deal. The Turtle is an iconic watch for Seiko, easily identified and recognized by its large cushion case, which just gives the watch this massive presence, regardless of which dial resides within. The current line of Turtles are actually a reissue after almost 30 years of dormancy, and this generation has a 45mm width case, and that's without the crown, width is 46.5. And that, right there, is really enough to scare a lot of people away before they even try one on. Which is kind of a shame, as the secret to the Turtle's success really lies in that cushion case, and a really short lug-to-lug of almost 47mm. And that just makes the Turtle surprisingly comfortable to wear on a variety of wrist sizes. Yet that extra width does add some weight to it, coming in at about 180 grams with its bracelet. So it's a tad heavier than some other options, but really not that bad. It's also not overly tall, sitting at 13.2 millimeters, and that's with a 200 meters diver's water resistant rating, so it is ISO certified. The overall dimensions of the case really make it sound a bit square, but that's not really a word I would use to describe a turtle. In fact, other than inside the lugs, there really isn't a right angle anywhere on this thing. It's all rather curvy and just seems to flow organically, with the sides tapering as they go to the case back, which is a closed case back with the typical ProSpec logo. When you look at it from the side, you can also see that the case just seems to curve as well, which I think helps the watch wear better as it just seems to conform more to your wrist. And all of this together just really give it a very distinct case shape, which does include a crown at the 345-ish position, which is just sort of tucked into a notch of the case. And with this position, the crown is pretty much out of the way, and it's actually very easy to unscrew and use, but it's not actually signed. And in some ways, it's kind of a disappointment and makes it look a little bit generic, at least compared to some micro brands around this price. Yet it is pretty typical for Seiko. The sides are polished, which along with that case shape just really lets it play with the light. And as you can see here, there are drilled lugs, which is always a nice bonus, especially from Seiko. Yet the top of the case is brushed, which you can clearly see as it does extend a bit beyond the dial and the bezel. And I have to say that this really has not only a tool-like appearance, but I think out of every diver I've looked at, this I think looks the most at home sitting outside a wetsuit, just ready to plunge into the water. However, being great in the water doesn't automatically mean it's great when you're sitting at a desk. And I think this is kind of a potential weakness. It all just depends on your point of view. While the case really is large and in charge, the dial is just regular sized. I haven't actually measured it, but I'm pretty sure it's the same size as an SKX or the new 5KXs. So even though you're wearing a larger watch, you're not really getting any more dial real estate. It's all just taken up by the case. And some are really going to see this as a negative, as it's kind of wasted space. Yet others might actually see this as part of the Turtle's unique style and charm. Now for me, this has been made really apparent recently, as I'm also working on a review of the Zelos Mako 3. And that watch really takes the opposite approach. It has a big dial, minimal case, and it's actually a smaller watch. Now, on the Dark Knight, we have an appropriate aluminum Batman-style bezel, and it does have your typical Seiko coin edge. It's also 120-click, unidirectional, and very little backplay. And amazingly, it's actually lined up with the dial. That bezel's not overly tall, and it is recessed a bit from the edge of the case. So it can be just a little bit harder to rotate than some other watches I've had. Although I have noticed that if you have the bracelet off, it's much easier to use, as you get some grip real estate at the 12 and 6. And the bezel edge does stick up just slightly above the flat crystal. And as for that crystal, well, I think you know what to expect. To paraphrase Henry Ford, you can have any crystal you want, as long as it's Hardlux. Which, really, at this point, it should be sapphire, and you'd expect it if you were getting it from a microbrand. Yet, this is still perfectly normal for Seiko. Now, onto the dial, which I have to say is by far my favorite Seiko dial to date. It's really what made me fall for this watch, and I still love looking at it even months later. Not to mention, it just simply looks fantastic in most of these photos. And it's all due to this unique sunburst, horizontal gradient dial, which is kind of the best way I can describe it. There's a dark blue stripe that sort of runs down the middle of the dial, and that slowly turns to black as you go left or right from it. And as you get to the edge, that black almost has a dark enamel finish to it, so it's rather shiny and no sunburst effect, which is actually more reserved for the middle section. It really just gives it a very different look, and it's just simply striking. And I think that really pairs perfectly with just the Batman bezel, as well as a black chapter ring on the edge of the dial. The overall layout here is very similar to an SKX, which also includes the handset, although here, the handset has more of a brushed finish than the polished one you'd have there. And I think that just really sets it apart from the dial and the indices beneath it. The 12, 6, and 9 indices are also more a blunt triangle shape than the rounded shapes on the SKX. All of the indices are white, and they all have this very thin metallic border, which just gently reflects the light back slightly. And this is more apparent on those black sections in the sunburst blue area. And all of the indices are just topped off with a very generous amount of lume. You also have a day date at the right, and it is just a simple cutout. Yet due to this gradient dial, it's encased in an entirely black section of it, which I don't really think disrupts the symmetry near as much, as the main symmetrical elements here are really a black, blue, and another black stripe running down. And along the same lines, you also have a fair amount of text, but here it's all encapsulated in the blue section, which is then framed by those black lines running on either side, which again, I think makes it seem more at place. One of Seiko's strengths is always their LumaBright lume and the generous amount they apply to their divers. So I think it's safe to say that the lume here is good. It may not be the best, but it's still pretty good. And I've actually been using this turtle in almost all of them. It's basically become my standard for what I consider to be good lume. So I didn't really run a specific test here, as all you have to do is watch almost any of my other videos. Now, movement-wise, we do have a Seiko 4R36, which is a step above the 7S26, which you find in most Seiko SKXs and older Seiko 5s. And for the most part, it just winds up adding hacking and hand-winding. It's a standard beat rate, 40-hour power reserve, and that hacking and hand-winding. It's also the same as the NH36A. In short, it's basically the best workhorse movement you can get at $300 and under. Yet, if you're paying more than that, it kind of starts to become debatable on whether you should get it or start looking for something with a Miyota 9015, at least when you start looking at microbrands. Which then leads us to the bracelet, which overall I think is pretty good for what it is, and I think a step up from a lot of Seiko 5s. The good news is that it does have solid end links, but the bad news is that it still has a stamped push button clasp. It's 22mm, but then tapers down to 20 at the clasp. Visually, I think it looks great with the turtle. It's mostly brushed with these two polished points on each link, which winds up giving it this nice linear look that just sort of draws your eyes towards the dial. Overall, it's a bracelet that you can wear for some time, so no need to upgrade it, but there are plenty of other options out there, including a few aftermarket bracelets. Yet on that bracelet, the Turtle wears surprisingly well, almost amazingly well for my 7-inch wrist. You don't really expect how comfortable it actually is given its size, but that short lug-to-lug and the cushion shape, they really do make a difference. Overall, I'm happy with the Turtle, and really glad I chose the Dark Knight. And if you're on the fence about a Turtle, but are concerned about its size, I can tell you that with my 7-inch wrist, it's really comfortable. And I think it might be one of the best watches for someone who wants a larger presence. But if you love the look, but are still concerned beyond that about the size, there is always the Mini Turtles. But I do need to mention that I haven't been wearing this near as much as I used to. And some of that has to do with the channel, where I always have something new to try on. But most of it is just from realizing over the months that I tend to prefer more of a slimmed down or trimmed down case than what you get with a cushion, even on watches that might be close in size. But that's just my preference. Although it's because of that cushion case and that unique dial that this watch has a safe place in my collection. I just don't have anything else that looks quite like it. So it's always there when I want something a little different. Now, before we wrap this up, there is a larger question at hand, and that's value. And prices of Turtles really range. I've seen some in the mid-200s, and some of the more exotic, maybe limited edition ones, almost up to six. Now, at the lower end, I think you're good. But as you go up, well, value pretty much goes out the window. Which, of course, brings up micro brands, where you can get a lot more variety and a lot more bang for your buck. So, in today's world of micro brands, is it really worth buying a low to mid-range Seiko Diver, let alone a Turtle? And the short answer is that no, it's not. But there's a longer answer that's a bit more complicated, and it's one we might explore in the future. But in the meantime, let me know down below what you think about this Turtle, or just Seiko Divers in general, and if you think they're worth it. And as always, if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks for joining me.